Today we're walking down memory lane. And what that means is we're following on a message I gave in the last session, which was on the subject of roots. And in it I declared to you that we should, as leaders, be open to share roots. This is the protection that God has given to us. And so naturally, I have to, if I'm going to speak with authority, I have to live up to the subject. And you've submitted quite a few questions, and I hope to be able to get to them and in the time that we're here. And out of these questions, my first desire is that the Lord will be glorified, that secondly, we will learn principles in the ways of God from them, and thirdly, that you'll get an understanding, a feel for my roots and those roots that may have affected or influenced Youth with a Mission and therefore became a part of the roots of the movement and ministry called Youth with a Mission. Someone asked the question about my grandfathers, and so I start back at that generation and say that my grandfather Cunningham was born in Tennessee, if I remember right, and my grandfather Nicholson in Harrison, Arkansas. And my grandfather Cunningham was studying to be to go into medicine, and when God called him to preach, he went into the ministry. And he was known as the Walking Bible. He was a teacher of the Word who had more of the Word memorized than any man I've ever met. And even up until my teens, when he died, he used to come and stay in our home and minister, and I would sit under his ministry. And he had a unique form of teaching. He would have the people read the scriptures as he would go on, and everyone would participate. If anyone misread a scripture, he would correct them. Even the word thee or and or anything left out, he wouldn't allow that to go on. And he lived in the Word. He slept in my room in the other bed, and I'd wake up in the middle of the night, and there he'd be over the Bible. All day long he was over the Bible. He was into the Word. The other grandfather was, Nicholson, was from a Presbyterian home and family, and his older brother was a Presbyterian pastor, but he was the black sheep of the family. And he became quite a fighter, and he was a red-headed, fiery man, and became enamored with alcohol. But at the age of around in his 40s, he came to know the Lord in a dramatic conversion. Now, Granddad Cunningham was known as a holiness preacher, and he would follow more in the line of the Wesleyan teaching. And Granddad Nicholson was also known as a holiness preacher. Now, the Nicholson clan, as far as I can understand, goes right back to the island of Skye and the Hebrides, which is a part of the Scottish islands there. And the Cunningham clan comes from the western part of Scotland and a place called Ayr. And they told me when I visited there with Duncan Campbell a few years ago, I explained that my roots, and they said, "Oh yes, many sheep stealers had to leave here, and they they went to America." So I've quit being so open about some of those things. I was just reading a manuscript my mom made, and mother and dad were over here recently in Europe, traveling throughout Europe. And they're in their 70s now, and she's written a manuscript telling of her early life. And it was really interesting to me. Since, she must have been 6 years of age when her dad was saved. And in a short amount of time, they were out evangelizing. And they were really evangelists. Granddad Nicholson was an evangelist till he died in his 80s. And I meet his converts all over the central part of the United States. People constantly coming up to me, "Oh, I was saved under your granddad, Nicholson." And he had five children, and they were all a part of their evangelistic team, as was his wife until she died. And they traveled in a covered wagon. And even in the cold winter blizzards, they would be out traveling in that way and try to find a place to duck into for the coldest times. But I was reading in the various things that took place, and I know that these things have had an influence through my mom. They were crossing a bridge on a major river running through Oklahoma, between Oklahoma and Texas, around that area. And the horses slipped and went off the edge. And the two babies, younger than my mother, were there in that covered wagon. And just as the wagon front end was off, my grandmother grabbed the wheel and said, "In the name of Jesus, stop this." And it stopped right there. Granddad cut the horses loose and they swam out, and my grandmother got the children out. They were ministering in a community, a farming community, and there was quite a move of God and real repentance sweeping through that community. And people that were coming to know the Lord, and there was deep repentance and open confession, and then the word of knowledge came forth and revealed sin. And so a man sued them, sued the whole church, sued every Christian, took them to court. And the day before the court trial, he was out plowing in his field, beautiful, clear, sunny day. One cloud came over, one lightning bolt struck him. He was dead, and there was no more trial. But the fear of God came over that whole community, and a church is there today. In fact, my granddad, though he didn't begin until he was 40, he was able to establish 18 churches across in the central part of the United States, south central. And so in this, the way their life was just simply they would seek the Lord as a family, and when he'd tell them to move, they would move to the next place. They'd come in, they'd hold open-air street meetings, and that's the way they would get started. And they'd come into what was known as being spirit-filled, as did my grandfather Cunningham. And at that time, there was quite a general move of God across much of that area of the United States along this line. And there came a doctrine in that was teaching what they called Jesus only. And it was starting to make an influence. So at that time, there was a formation of a new denomination called the Assemblies of God. And so my grandfather felt that the churches he had started should have some protection, and he put them into that particular denomination. And he then himself later became ordained with them, as did my grandfather Cunningham. And so they were really pioneers in that particular denomination. The first things that I remember in my own life, and this you'll begin to see is some of the greatest influences on my life, was the question. When I was born in California, near Los Angeles, 100 miles north, and the first thing I remember is when my dad had moved down to a place called Somerton, Arizona. This is a place right on the border of Mexico, and it's a desert region. A lot of very poor people live there, and so we were identified, there's no doubt about it. Now, Dad had been called into the ministry when he was 19 years of age. God spoke to him in a very dramatic way. He was foreman of a construction team on a hotel. And he really wanted to get into contracting and into engineering. That was his goal. And he was several stories up, six stories high on the hotel at that time, walking those narrow beams as those construction men did, and there weren't a lot of safety rules back in those days either. And there was some jealousy because of, I think, his youth. He was the leader of men that were much older than he was. And this is hard to say for sure, but all indicators pointed that way. The one that seemed to hate him most seemed to be the one that had the accident and pushed the lumber at him and knocked him off. And when he fell off, there was some lumber hanging out, and he grabbed one piece of lumber hanging there, six stories high. And some other men came and pulled him in. And it's easy to hear God in a time like that. And God had been speaking to him quite regularly, and he went over on the other side, and he says, "All right, God, you've got my attention. I will go into the ministry." And there was no glamour for him. He knew what it was all about. But in the process, his older sisters offered him to send him on through and get his degree in engineering and set him up into any business he wanted. But they said if he did go into the ministry, they'd have nothing to do with him. And that was just the line that was drawn, especially the older sister. And the reason for her bitterness was their mother had died very early. My dad was 6 years old, when his mother died, and my granddad had gone to pray for some poor people, some Mexican people that had smallpox. The next day he came home, and the following day my grandmother came down with smallpox and died. And so as a 13-year-old, my oldest aunt blamed the ministry for killing her mother. Now, the incubation time of smallpox is much longer than that. But even as an adult, when she learned that, she would not give up her bitterness. Bitterness is finally a choice. It's not a cause of our sin. It is the choice, and therefore is sin. And there's temptation to bitterness, but bitterness is sin. It's a choice. So this is why she wanted nothing to do with Dad if he was going to go into the ministry. And when we were in Somerton, we lived in a tent. Someone has said that maybe that's why YWAM uses tents so much. And we had boxes for furniture. And I just, on Saturday, told this story, and one of the YWAMers came up, Bobby Peterson. Her husband is Arnie. And she came up to me afterwards, and she said, "Have you ever heard the name Frank Ubeda?" And I said, "Yes, I have. I've heard of that name all my life." She says, "That's my father. He was your dad's translator into Spanish there on the Mexican border." And it's just interesting. And now she's in as a part of the YWAM staff. That time, though, is the time when I start remembering things as a little child, 2, 3, 4, 5 years old. And church and evangelism was everything. That was all of our life. When we played as my older sister, 2 years older than myself, I have another sister, 10 years younger, three of us. When my sister and I played, we played church. We didn't know anything else. And I preached, and she would lead the singing. And that was a part of our life, too. One morning, my mom came and said to us, we were playing church, and she said, "You want to go to town with me, kids?" My sister turned to me, and she said, "Demon, do you feel led?" I think her theology was mixed up. At least her discernment. But the terminology was all part of the life, too. By the time I was 3, I was singing on the streets or in church or even on the radio at that time. We started a radio broadcast. And so that became a part of my life, too. But in our street meetings, as we would hold them. We'd take the pattern of holding them every Saturday night. That's when the people were in town. That's when the contacts were made, and a lot of people got saved through that. My job would be to hand out literature and sing, and then a little later on, I started playing the trumpet. That reached out a little further and made a little more noise anyway. One night, I remember 7 years of age, we would now move to El Centro, and we were on the street for our Saturday night street meeting, and the Lord just spoke to my parents to close and leave. Real quick, just abrupt word, do it now. And so they immediately obeyed the Lord, got in the car, pulled out from the curb. As we pulled out from the curb, there on the sidewalks in the desert, they had at that time what they call porticos. They would have the second story, the first story up, would extend over the sidewalk. This protected from the heat of the sun in the day. And when the earthquake came, it immediately knocked down many buildings in town. People were buried alive right there on the streets. One family, the man and boy, got out of the car on the street side, the mother and daughter on the sidewalk side. They were buried before the eyes of their the husband and father and son. And a lot of people died at that time. For several weeks, we all slept outside, everyone did, in town, because of the earthquake tremors that continued. And it was a terrible earthquake. Some funny things occurred, though, as well. There was a man, for example, in a hotel taking a bath. When the earthquake came, he ended up on the street with nothing but his hat on. he got out in a hurry. all those weights that entangled him, he left behind. It's amazing how diligent you can be under those circumstances. The time of my conversion is very real to me, but some would discount it because of the age. But I was 6 years of age when God was moving in our particular church group in a special way. Many people were getting saved, and there was a general move of God. It was during the summer months, and there was a Sunday school bus sitting out behind the church. And every day there must have been 12 of us or so, children, ages 5, 6, 7, 8, in that age bracket, that would pray for several hours a day. And because of the move of the Spirit, we were sensing it and really having a hunger for God. My prayer all week was, God save me. God save me. My parents knew the Lord, and I knew the Lord only through them. It was an awareness that had come upon me that I needed to know the Lord personally. Sunday night was the night that I gave my heart to the Lord, and it was a time when the Lord personally just revealed himself to me in salvation. I don't have any doubts about it. It's very real. I can look back on it as though I were an adult. I just remember it that well. It's a spiritual experience, and I believe that children are more spiritually aware than we give them credit. In fact, I think they're not as encumbered as people older who have the scars of sin in their lives. And following that time, I was able to win several other children to the Lord. It became, I would say, especially in those days up through into my teenage life, that I won many of them to the Lord. That was a way of life. But my highlight, I think, was when I was 10, when I won my first adult to the Lord. He was a businessman. And I think of this now as I see the King's Kids Ministry of Youth with a Mission out, children winning adults to the Lord, even in red light districts. Recently, they were witnessing in Honolulu, and a little boy, Joshua, I don't know how old Joshua is, 7, I think, came up to a man and asked him, what his name was, and he gave him a foul name. Little Joshua didn't even know it was a vulgar name, and it wasn't a name at all. And he just repeated it back. He says, "Well, mister," and call this name out. He said, "You know that Jesus wants to save you." And the guy couldn't take it when he saw what had happened, and he broke and wept and wept and wept. He was a transvestite, and a homosexual trying to be a woman, and he just, as a result of this, gave his heart to the Lord, left that way of life, and others began to disciple him. I believe that children can be used of the Lord. The Bible says a little child shall lead them, and we must become as little children to enter into the kingdom of heaven. Also at age 10, I met and led a new friend to the Lord. His name was Jimmy Abbott. He was a year or two older than me, and I lived by this time in the western part of Los Angeles. And when we were 12, Jim Abbott started in and did well for a while, but then just as he went into his teen life, he felt he was going to miss out on something. And being in the city, we had a real black and white situation. Either you live for God, or we were in an area where drugs were being used long before drugs became a problem in most of the world. So he got involved in pushing drugs, and he was shot by the police when he was trying to get away when he was age 19. He was to be married the next day, along with two other fellows. I knew all three of them very well. And he was hit in the spine. He today is in a wheelchair, still pushing drugs, totally an invalid. Don Bennett, another fellow I used to bring to church, he never would give his heart to the Lord. I witnessed to him just a few days before he was murdered at age 16. Kenny Griswold, another fellow I brought to church, he tried to get me to go to the parties with him. He loved to drink, and at age 15, he was murdered. At the same time, I had other acquaintances and friends that were just on the opposite side, and they were sold out to the Lord. So I had that contrast at all times. And because through those years, we were constantly down on the streets preaching every Saturday night, and my friends would come by and wave at me as I was playing the trumpet, and we had that kind of understanding and relationship. And I think that that really brought a lot of strength into my life. And I encourage parents, as I did in Spain, of our staff, get your children involved in evangelism. I think that that's how William Booth not only saw his family protected from the sins of that day, which were gross, but by putting them on the offense, the children were never enamored by some kind of a mystique or a glamour about sin. Our children that are working in the red light district have a deep concern and even a pity for those that are involved in those kinds of gross sins that are destroying the people socially and personally as well as spiritually. And it just takes away the mystique. And I think that's a wonderful defense, is to go on the offense. But otherwise, exposure, of course, isn't good. I think only exposure when you're on the offense. It was when we were 12, a group of us, about six, were fasting and praying because, again, there was a move of God in the church. We went for over a year in which we saw many people come to the Lord every week. And this was in a part of Los Angeles where I lived up until I guess I was 19. And at that particular time, as we fasted and prayed, I had an experience that we call the infilling of the Holy Spirit. And it was a wonderful time for me of a breakthrough of an overflow of God. the following year, when I was 13, God called me into the ministry. I was at that time visiting with my cousins, and their name was Paris. Leland Paris was one of them, and he received the call from the Lord the same night. It was a Monday night, and we were in the place of prayer for about 2 hours. And God just broke through and made the call very clear to me. He gave me the word, Mark 16:15, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. So I knew I was called to the ministry. I knew it was international. I didn't know anything more than that, but I went to my mother. Dad had gone back to his pastoral responsibilities, and so we extended our holidays a couple of 3 weeks later. And it was during that time. I went to Mom and I said, Mom, God's called me into the ministry. And she says, fine. And the next day she took me down and bought me a new pair of shoes, because the Bible says how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel. I had that experience. One of the things that Mom felt right away is that I needed to express it. If you have a word from the Lord, you shouldn't delay your obedience. And so the following Thursday night, I spoke my first sermon. And it was in a tolerant situation. My uncle was the pastor, and his group of farmers that were the members. And so they all sat there, and some consider it the greatest miracle of my ministry. I was able to speak less than 10 minutes. It's amazing what hardness of heart does. But in the process of growing up in that period of time in Los Angeles, someone asked me about my roles and even jobs and so on. I started selling papers in Los Angeles when I was 10 up until I was 15, and also took a couple of other jobs, washing dishes in a restaurant, and then into delivering chicken dinners to homes. I was the delivery boy. But at 15, I was able to get a job far more respectable in Ralph's grocery store as a boxologist. So I would take the groceries and put them into boxes. And then I was 17 when I came out of high school, and then enrolled in university. In that first year at UCLA, I became a produce person in the grocery store, took care of the vegetables. But I went with 11 other fellows down into Mexico, and by and large, during that period of time, I mostly just spoke in youth gatherings. But we went into Mexico, and Mom had always brought in people to minister to them in our home. We had a 3-bedroom home. It wasn't too big, but there was always room for somebody that was trying to get off of alcohol or had just had a mental breakdown or something. We just had a Mercy Ministry home. And I remember one guy came in. He was being hunted by the mafia. And she tried to get him to give his heart to the Lord. He almost was persuaded, and then he bolted. The next week he was shot. Well, he was beaten to death, actually, in Las Vegas. Out on the deserts, the mafia got a hold of him. We also had, for 1 year, a missionary son living with us, and the missionary son was from Mexico. And so he spoke Spanish, and as a result, I was learning from him, and we ended up speaking it all the time we could in the home, he and I. And As a result, I was able to converse pretty freely in Spanish at that time. And in Mexico, I would use my Spanish and even speak publicly there. And we went down evangelizing, passing out literature, preaching on the streets, witnessing and preaching in churches. And I think we learned a lot through that, and one that would be a real impression on my life of what young people could do for God. We were really on our own, and just doing what God was showing to us to do, and we saw many people come to the Lord. One morning, we slept out in the desert at night, and we in sleeping bags, and we'd come in by day, but one morning we woke up and bullets were falling around our little campsite. So persecution had come, and we broke camp in a hurry. Found out it is a man target practicing, and he didn't even know we were over there, so there went our story of persecution. 3 of us ended up in the hospital with amoebic dysentery. They call it Montezuma's revenge. And that's why Mexico isn't evangelized yet. In case you didn't know. That was the year of 1953. It was when I was 19 that I felt the Lord direct me to go back to Bible college. And I shared that with my parents. I'd finished my first year of university. And they prayed about it and felt it was right. And in fact, they mortgaged their home so my sister and I could go together and go to Bible school. And we went to Missouri, Springfield, Missouri, to Central Bible College, it's called now. And I was there about a month and started looking around, and another guy and I went out into the hills of the Ozarks, is where the setting is. And we went door to door to all the farms, and this wasn't an assignment, this is just something came out of our heart's desire. And to start a church. So we went out and started a church. And I became the pastor of the Green Hill Community Church. It's quite a tremendous title. And we eventually had about 50 people. I was just there for a year until the next summer. And by that time, we'd formed a singing group. There were 5 of us fellows, and we were going to go out evangelizing in the summer, which we did. And we went all over the United States in a vehicle, a car. And in fact, that summer, we had 120 services in 90 days in 42 states. And if you know anything about the United States, the breadth of it and so on, we were moving fast. In fact, we'd often drive all night, travel all night, and then minister the next night, and we were doing, I guess, what I do now, traveling. But in it, I look back and I see all the ways of God in the people I met during those days. That particular summer, we preached in a little church in Pennsylvania, and I was in the home of this young pastor, and he impressed me. He's one of these guys that had vision, and so he'd say, "Now you guys do what God shows you." You know, real straightforward type guy. I don't know it mean anything to you, but his name was David Wilkerson, and that was 1955. And through the years, David has been a real friend. In fact, just 2 weeks ago, he said, "I want you to know I'm really behind that ship project. I'm giving you $10,000 for it. And I'm going to raise you $40,000 more for the ship," he said. And so that's what he's doing right now. He's been a real blessing at crucial times, key times, and also correcting times. He's straightforward. If he sees something needs to be said, he says it. But he's a real encourager, a tremendous man of God. I met key people. I keep thinking how God is interweaving our lives, every day of our lives, if we'll only understand that. It's not some kind of staccato thing that suddenly happens and you're ripped away and you do this and that. It's a growth. It's like a tree. And as we grow in the Lord, then we bear fruit. I believe that's the way it goes, and we're blended together. And so I want to be alert every day. What is it that God's wanting to say today, and who is it, and why? And that's, I think, always important to find out all along the way. Through this process, by the way, out of those times, I spent 3 years doing that, traveling. And in the United States, Missouri is right here, sort of the navel of America. And being there, we would travel out on the weekends from Bible college. And I was also taking, during part of that time, courses at another school across town. And so I arranged my schedule in a way that from Friday noon, we had off until Monday morning. And we would book out our services in youth rallies or whatever opportunity we could all over the United States. And we'd jump in the car, we'd be all packed Friday morning, go to our classes, jump in the car, and head out. For example, we'd go up to Minnesota on the weekend. We'd go to Milwaukee, we went to Ohio, we went to Florida 3 times. It's nice in the winter to go to Florida. It's easy to hear God's voice during those days. South Carolina, Texas, we just, Kansas, all over the place, we would go on the weekends. So that meant we'd drive all night long, usually, and come back in Monday morning, drive in just in time to get into our class, and then sit there and take our courses. So there's something about apprenticeship, though, that's important. I still believe in that principle very strongly. I think if you get all intake and no outgive, you become stagnant, and the issues are not clear. You don't learn truth unless you apply it. You learn to know about truth, and that becomes condemnation. And I think that the more you take in, the more you have to give out. To whom much is given, much is required. And so I don't look at those times in any way but a positive time, and certainly relationships were born out of those times of ministries where I met people that today are leaders in various ways in the body of Christ, and we have a long friendship and relationship that developed through those days of ministry. It was in 1956. I was 19 years of age at that time. And I was in Miami, Florida. And we were ministering around that area. And I had heard that I had an aunt living in Miami, Florida. So I looked up in the phone book, and sure enough, there was her name. Now, I had never been able to meet her in my lifetime, because when she cut my dad off, she wouldn't answer a phone call, a letter, even a Christmas card for 29 years. And she said, I totally disown you. And she was, in my eyes, quite well off. She owned a furniture factory and about 5 stores, furniture stores, in which she would sell around that area of southern Florida. And so I called her up and said I was in town and I wanted to meet her, and she hung up on me. So the next day, I thought, well, I'll try again. So I called her again. This was Saturday. And this time she says, I can't see you. I'm too busy. My employees are having a birthday party for me. Well, I found out 2 things. One, she was giving me excuse. She didn't hang up, so that was gaining. And 2, she was having a birthday. So I got her a birthday card and a little handkerchief. And then following morning, I guess it was following afternoon, we were getting ready to leave town from Miami to go to another city further north for that evening. And I just called her again and I said, I have a little birthday card I want to give you and I just want to meet you. I noticed on the address that you're only a block and a half off of the street we're going by. And I'll just take just 10 minutes if you'll see me. And she said, well, and then she said, okay. So I went by and handed her the card. I didn't realize what God was setting up. I was 19. My dad had been 19 the last time she saw him. And as I walked up and said hello to her, she began to weep. And God began to use that to minister into her life. I prayed with her many times before she died, but she died very bitter, an alcoholic, would not give her life to the Lord, because every time we'd get down on her knees and she'd say, now, Lord, I want to be forgiven now of all my sins. And I'd say to her, will you forgive your dad? She says, never. Now, this was for something her dad didn't even do, make her mother die of smallpox. Even though she was an adult and understood, she clung to her bitterness till her death. But she said to me on that day, she said, Lauren, you've got another aunt, and she would like to meet you. She had been in conversation with her sister. And she was a blank to me, too. I didn't know anything about her. And she said she was quite wealthy. Well, I thought she was quite wealthy. But I told her where we were going, and I would be speaking at different places and so on. And I was to be in Montreal, Canada. And she said, well, they're at their summer home in Lake Placid, New York, upper New York. And she gave the itinerary to her. And she sent her chauffeur to pick me up after church. I was speaking in a church in Montreal. And the guys all said to me, now remember us. <You know? laughs> When you get in Pharaoh's household. So I had never entered into a world like that. I went into luxury, and when I came to their summer home, which was just a mansion sitting on the beautiful lake, they used it a couple of months a year, and they called it their camp. And they had several servants around, and I'd push the button in the morning. They'd bring breakfast in bed, and, you know, quite a hospitality department. And I met a lot of wealthy people in their home. I didn't know they existed. Heads of oil companies and major corporations known around the world. And through that, I didn't know what God was saying or preparing me for, but it was obviously not exactly YWAM as we know it. But anyway, through that time, they also had a home that they bought from the Vanderbilts down in Florida for their winter time. And it was a beautiful place in Palm Beach, Florida. And their regular home was in Providence, Rhode Island. So I would visit them from time to time when I was passing through that part of the world and stay in their home up to 2 weeks at a time. And they became very kind to me. And my uncle one time gave me 10 sport coats all the same time, most from Saks Fifth Avenue. I'd never, you know, that was more than my suitcase could carry. And they were kind in a lot of ways. And then just to give the chronology of it, in 57, I graduated from Bible College, and I was able to get 2 degrees within the same year, bachelor degrees. One in Bible and the other one in Christian education, because of the extra courses I'd been taking. And then I also, they want to ask about my first faith project. And I got to thinking about that. I can't tell you my first time, because whenever we lived in a desert in Arizona with boxes, I remember Mom praying for a house, and we got the house. I don't remember that part. I remember after we got the house, but I remember her praying for the furniture to fill the house, and a woman coming in, Mrs. Wilbanks, and she said she had some furniture God wanted her to give, and it was a direct answer to prayer. And as a child, the least little things we would pray for, and God would do. And so I grew up in that framework. I don't know of any time that I didn't know that way of life. I cannot recall the beginnings of it. But I remember as my money was run out at Bible school, and I'd been out evangelizing, didn't make much money that way for sure. And so I came back at my last year of college, and I was to be the student body president that year, and I had a lot of responsibilities, plus we were going to still travel out all the weekends, which we did, all but one that year. And I was behind the school, there was a creek bed, and I was back there praying and asking God to supply my money if he wanted me to go this year of school, otherwise I would go wherever he said. And I walked up from that place past the administration building, and the receptionist looked out and saw me, and she said, "Lauren, there's someone on the phone for you right now." So I went in there, and it was my aunt. And she said, "Lauren, your uncle and I have been talking, and we were wondering if you needed any money for school." And so I said, "Yeah." And so that was God's answer to prayer in a very direct way, in a major way for me. And then the next year, they said that they would go ahead and sponsor me at USC, which was a very expensive school, still is. And so I went to Southern California. My father was pastoring in Long Beach, and he asked me to be assistant pastor with him while I went to university. So I went full-time to university, and also pretty well kept a full-time job going too at the church. And then I was invited to be associate pastor at a larger church, and I directed the choirs there. We had six choirs. The one prior to me was Ralph Carmichael and Bob Bowman and some very well-known names in the area of music, so I think the choir directed me instead of me them. We also had a large orchestra. I loved it. At Christmas time, the orchestra was, I don't know, 40, 50 pieces, and we'd have a 100-voice choir singing the Hallelujah Chorus. Whoo! You don't have to be a director to do that. You just ride, pick up your feet. And at the same time, we put on dramas. My last year in school, I instituted something in our college. We had about 800 students there, and they had never had a major dramatic production before. And so to get this one into the school was a major thing. That drama, you know, it wasn't always looked on as the most spiritual thing. And so we did a play, a missionary play, and it was on a missionary that had died in Central America. It was on Orrin Munger's life story, and he was a songwriter and a missionary. And so I played that role of Orrin, and Orrin Munger. Orrin? That's his brother. Anyway, I think that's right. But that was a new beginning there in the school, and I was also the leader of a prayer group, Latin American prayer group. We would pray for Latin America. Somebody's asking the question, do I have a burden for Mexico and Central America in particular? But yes, I very much have been involved there and have deep desires for that part. But I began to start dramas in the church, too, around special occasions, and had a lot of fun doing that kind of thing. I was the head of the youth department, which we had three different youth groups, and also the Christian education department. And so at the same time, I was taking 18 hours, mostly graduate studies at USC. So I was full. I've always maybe been in a hurry, but I'm fulfilled in having a full life. I think it's my view that everybody has different capacities, and your job is not to try to compete or compare, But it's to live to your capacities within the realm that God gives you and the gifts and through the grace of God. And in doing so, you're released to the fullness. If you're slack, even the things that you do will be, because they're half-hearted, they won't be as good as what you can do when you're full throttle. And I don't think that, I think an idle mind is the devil's workshop. I think an idle body is not of God either. I think we're to be involved, and that's what life is all about. And so it was during that time that I got another bachelor's degree in philosophy and then went on and got a master's degree in education. And in 1960, I finished university. I resigned from the place of the church, and this is where I need to bring in and answer one of the areas of the questions. At that time, I had been ordained, one of the younger to be ordained in our movement, my denomination rather. And when God began to speak to me about taking young people out in evangelism, it came in the form of a vision in prayer of, I saw the map of the world. It was a relief map, and the continents were all clear, and it was in color, and the waves were coming into the continents along the shores, but each wave went beyond the last wave until the wave seemed to gain momentum and then spread across every continent of the world. And those waves turned into waves of young people preaching the gospel. And it was at that time that God was stirring my heart to launch the ministry of Youth with a Mission. I shared it with a few men of God. They all had their different ministries. None of them ever became a part of Youth with a Mission in a full-time way. They had their own full-time ministries. They came together as a board and felt this was of God and released me. And at that time, we chose the name Youth with a Mission. And we started out. And they served for many years over Youth with a Mission. Then as Youth with a Mission started branching out and multiplying into other nations, God spoke to me that we needed an international eldership. And at that time, he showed me the ones that I should get would be those that had had ministry on all the places that YWAM had ministered in, and that they should be people that had now moved into YWAM and had YWAM experience. We have 7 men on the International Council. They are over me. I am not over them. I am a part of them, and it's plurality, equality. I'm the chairman, but as far as the group is concerned, we have correction for one another. We have a close relationship of many years. We meet every 3 months, and we always begin our time before the Lord. It normally begins in a time of worship. And then we'll go into intercession, interceding for YWAM and what God shows us. And inevitably, not always, but almost always, it'll end up in ministry one to another. We just met a few days ago at the beginning of this month. And during that time, God started dealing with us, and we ministered to one another in confession or whatever was needed to be done, restitution. It was made, and then in that unity, we began to move into the questions, and we try to take them all before the Lord. And any question of any policy, new direction, new vision, whatever, other than reporting one to the other, we ask the Lord, and we go to the Lord in prayer and wait upon the Lord for an answer. And until we get a unanimity, we do not make a decision. We must all be in agreement. And I think if you don't have unity, then even what you do is going to be hampered. God does not command blessing when there is not unity. When there is unity, God commands the blessing. And so I would rather wait and get unity and actually speed up the time than try to save time and not have unity. And so we have that structure on an international basis, and then as the works grew, Then we have a council over each one of the three regions. The one in Pacific and Asia is now being formed and has been prayed over, and that's right now taking place. But we have them over, we have three regions. Europe, Middle East, and Africa is one of them. The Americas the other. Pacific and Asia is the other. And we've never felt to make our decisions on the basis of any other than the standards of the Word of God. And it does include, for example, the word novice. There is some kind of experience, length of time in ministry leadership roles, the type of ministry one has, the international calling one has. All of these things have to do with the choice of leaders as we wait upon God. But it's God that must confirm that there is a certain leader. Some would ask the question why we only have two nationalities in the International Council. Well, we didn't choose it that way. We chose people that God chose. We didn't ever choose on any other basis. I don't notice nationalities as much. I honestly don't. I think I've been living so much abroad all my life from my own country that I long ago passed over that kind of a thing in my own thinking. But I believe, as I see others coming up, that God will in His time branch it out, especially into the third world. That's the direction maybe I'll talk about a little more in a later session. Before going much further in this area, though, there's a block of time that I want to start on when we come back from our break. And I've led you up pretty well to the beginnings of Youth with a Mission. And in the next session, I'm going to talk about the early days of Youth with a Mission, answering some of these questions that you've put forward that relate during that period of time. And why did we begin here in Switzerland? Why a lot of things. But let's take a little break now, and we'll come together after the break.